let's stick to the original plan then. 1 hour kind of interview where I would mostly keep quiet and let you speak. And as I wrote, I'd be grateful if you could elaborate on the last three chapters, and in particular on the subchapter in Science We Trust, because I think that would be one of the key.
Yes.
So please, the floor is yours.
Okay. Feel free to, interrupt or steer me in a different direction. And how much do you want me, how much do you want me to just like kind of review what I said?
Let's make the perhaps unwarranted assumption that people have read by the time you. Okay. Please enlarge on these. I'm particularly interested in. As I wrote also that the reference to Bert, and that would be for me personally the metaphysical foundations of modern science. That is a particular interest of me personally. Yes. So
right. Yeah, so I mean, I'll just start and say that people would, we have this idea, this conceit, that we have as a civilization, we've moved beyond superstition, we've moved beyond religion, we've moved beyond ritual. Religion is this kind of embarrassing relic of the past that some people are still stuck in, but society in general has moved beyond that. And we no longer take things on faith. Instead, we rely on the scientific method. And what I am describing in the chapter in Science We Trust is that in fact, we're doing nothing different than we ever have done as human beings. We are still believers of a religion, and we call that religion science. And just like, just like previous religions, say Christianity, more ancient religions, who believed that this is the truth, we also believe this is the truth. So in what way are we any different? Well, somebody might say, well, we're different because we don't just take it on faith. We do experiments. We ask questions of reality, and we humble ourselves to the answers that we receive from the reality that we question. And the question takes the form of hypothesis testing, takes the form of experiments. And how do I know that this is a reliable question to answer? Because anybody else can do the same experiment. And if my experiment was authentic, then they will get the same answer that I did. So another culture, another religion might call that divination. They would say, well, yeah, we do the same thing. We ask questions by, flipping coins or pulling yarrow sticks and consulting the I Ching, or consulting the oracle bones, or consulting the chicken entrails. We do, and don't tell us that it's not empirical, because these things work. They believe the same as we believe. In fact, you might say, well, theirs don't actually work. They're just engaging in wishful thinking. They're engaging in selection bias. They are only remembering the times where it did work. They have cultural and institutional ways to protect their beliefs. Well, guess what? We have the same thing. Experiments that conflict with established paradigms, or scientific findings that conflict with established paradigms, they get squeezed out. They get squeezed out in many, many ways. It's a lot harder to publish something that contradicts established biases. It's hard even to get it funded. And if you do publish it, it will be subjected to a lot of hostile scrutiny. So, and then there's even, you know, weirder stuff where there's big controversies about replicability today. Some huge proportion of scientific research is, no one ever tries to replicate it, or when they do, it turns out that it is not replicable. So I think I might in the book cite some examples of this, but it's been a big controversy in science. And so this is, so just to say that our naive belief that we don't take anything on faith is, well, naive. And then there's the level of what we do take on faith, which I call that the metaphysical foundations of science. And so one of these is the very idea that you can, that you can replicate an experiment. Because after all, if I do an experiment, I mix some chemicals in a test tube and I get some, and it turns yellow, the totality of those conditions include not just those chemicals, but the time and place in which the experiment was conducted and the person who conducted it. So if you go and you're like, okay, I'm going to repeat that experiment, I'm going to mix those chemicals together, are you actually repeating the experiment? No, because you're doing it at a different time, different place, and you're a different person. So we assume as a matter of faith that this is a dogma, okay? This is a religious dogma. We assume as a matter of faith that the variables of time, place, and person do not matter. Why do we think that? Well, because we have a causal theory that excludes those. That causal theory is, again, something that we take on faith. So part of the metaphysical basis of science is that everything happens because it's caused to happen by four fundamental forces. Things don't just happen in any meaningful way by themselves. And furthermore, that the consciousness, the beliefs, the desires, the state of being of the experimenter or the observer are not a relevant variable. That is an irrelevant variable that you can separate out. It's an independent variable. That's a pretty big assumption. Another metaphysical assumption is that everything real can be measured, which means reduced to number, that there's nothing qualitative in the universe that cannot be counted or weighed or somehow converted into numbers. So all of these, whether they are true or not, they are part of a mythology that we live in. And, you know, that might seem like just some philosophical thing, but then it plays out in our medical system. It plays out in our, you know, environmental policies, like the prejudice that the important stuff is the stuff that can be measured, or the real stuff is the stuff that can be measured. Well, what's easiest to measure? What's easiest to measure in the environmental realm is carbon dioxide. You know, that converts into one number. What if we wanted to base our public policy on biodiversity? That's a lot harder to measure. You could try to measure the number of species or the number of organisms, but really what's important is the relationship between those organisms, the complexity of those relationships. And I guess there are actually ecologists who are trying to devise metrics for complexity and biodiversity, but it's not a trivial matter to do that, and certainly difficult to convert into, you know, something like carbon credits. So that's, you know, why this philosophy is so important. And I don't know, Harda, feel free to follow up if you have anything else you want me to talk about there.
Yeah, please. I had what I picked up, this as a four forces. as opposed to four causes of Aristotle. Maybe you can, I mean, I don't know your plan, but if you can integrate that into your
So all of those forces are what Aristotle would have called an efficient cause.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
And you know, he was aware that there are other kinds of causality that, like, for example, the formal cause, where things tend toward maybe an ideal form. And I'm not sure if I want to try to I'm not even sure if I remember the other causes. It's been a long time since university.
Material, formal, efficient, and final.
Final, right. Right. So the final cause is like a teleological.
Yeah, the teleological, yeah. Yeah.
Right. And that implies some kind of I would even say wanting, some kind of yearning, some kind of striving on behalf of the world to move towards something. You know, otherwise you wouldn't call it a cause. And in our daily experience, you know, when someone says, well, why did you do that, Hardo? Mm. Why did you,
I've asked this question many times for myself.
Yeah, why did you do it? Like, usually the answer we give is because I wanted to something, like because I wanted to achieve something. Very rarely do we say, well, you know, a biochemical cascade started in my brain, you know, and released these peptides that completed a synaptic junction and caused my motor neurons to, like, we don't usually invoke an efficient cause.
Because we don't experience that, we just experience wanting.
That's right, right. And so science says that, well, that's just an illusion. What's real is this biochemical level, and what's real are these deterministic. I mean, this is actually obsolete science. The ideology of science is obsolete, even within science. But this idea that the world is determined by fundamental forces. That's so that any wanting, it's like, yes, it might be useful to think in terms of the alligator wants to eat a fish, but really what's happening is that, you know, certain chemical processes, that's what wanting actually is. It's a very dispiriting way to look at the world. So, yeah. I think that I don't know, I could relate it to environmentalism and climate change too. Mm-hmm. Because the one cause that's recognized as real by science, the efficient cause, is part of a mechanistic worldview. You know, it sees, I mean, if you look at the world that way, then what is illusory isn't only desire and wanting, but life itself, love itself, consciousness itself. All of these things are just epiphenomena, illusions that, you know, at base, it's just a bunch of protons, neutrons, and electrons bouncing around. That's all it is. So if you love something, that is, again, it's like some biochemical thing happening inside of you. And it's kind of like a delusion. Why should you love, why would you love a, let me get a little prop here. Here we are. Here's a sock, okay? And if I said, Hardo, I love my sock. I love it. And you're like, well, it does look like a very nice sock. You know, I bet it keeps your foot warm. And I'm like, no, you don't understand. It's not just for its use that I love it. Like, I love my wife, okay? And if you said, if you said, why do you love your wife? And I said, well, you know, she's a good cook, you know, and she takes good care of the child, you know, and she does all kinds of nice things for me. And you'd say, that's not love, Charles. Love isn't that you love her for what she does. Love is that you love her for what she is. And I say, well, okay, I love my, you don't understand. I don't just love my sock for that it keeps my foot warm and that it looks nice. I love my sock because of what it is. I just love my sock. Like that, you would think that I'm crazy. Well, what if we have a worldview that essentially says that everything is like my sock? I mean, what's the sock? You know, it's a bunch of subatomic particles, just like you, just like my wife, just like the trees, just like the forest, just like the world. That's the basic metaphysics underneath science as an ideology. So why would you love the world? And so here in environmentalism, ever since like the 80s, the narrative has been take better care of the world because of the bad things that'll happen to us if we don't. Back in the 70s, it was different. Like that was the day of save the whales. No one was saying if we don't save the whales, terrible things will happen to humanity. Save the whales because they're magnificent, because they're beautiful, because we love them. I think we need to reclaim that impulse behind environmentalism and not say, you know, let's save the planet because it keeps my feet warm. Save the planet because it's useful to us. It is useful to us. And the sock is useful to me. However, if you use that argument, it is also true. You're also saying that if the planet isn't useful to us, then it's not worth saving. And right now we have technology being developed that makes the planet less and less necessary for us. Synthetic food, space colonies, you know, space travel, geoengineering that doesn't require life to maintain the planetary, to maintain the climate, you know, like, I mean, there's far more money is going into these than is going into healing and protecting ecosystems. Okay. So
what caused that shift? You said that 70, what's your opinion on that one? What caused that shift? You said that in the 70s, it was more like love-based environmentalism, and now it's did bureaucracy just appropriate the whole issue, or what's the game there?
Yeah, I mean, I think partly it's, you know, bureaucracy and financial interests and so forth. Partly though, it's a desire by environmentalists to be legitimate. Hmm. What's legitimate is if you can frame your arguments in scientific terms.
Right.
Also, what's legitimate is if you can frame them in economic terms.
Right.
Because otherwise, we environmentalists, we seem like a bunch of tree huggers, you know, a bunch of hippies, a bunch of of ungrounded, unscientific people. So, okay, let's be scientific. So we invented the word sustainability, mm-hmm. which mm-hmm. is about ourselves. You know, can we keep doing it? So that way you can have a dispassionate, it's like, yeah, I don't actually care about the whales, but you know, if we continue killing them, then the ocean will be less healthy and sequester less carbon or something like that. Yeah, I don't actually care about, I'm not a tree hugger, you know? I'm fine with cutting them down and making lumber out of them and building houses out of them and paper mills. But you know, if we do that, it's not sustainable. So part of it, I think, is an abdication of our knowing about what's important and why we're here, and it's also like a loss of faith. You know, it's like instead of appealing to you, say you're a corporate polluter or somebody or a government official. And in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, you're a bad person. I know that you don't care about the world. All you care about is your money. All you care about is your position. All you care about is your public image. So I'm going to appeal to those things. I'm going to appeal to your self-interest. I'm going to appeal to the numbers because I know I can't appeal to your heart. That's a very dim view of human nature. And it's a scientific view of human nature. Because at the basis of evolutionary biology is the idea that organisms seek to maximize their reproductive self-interest. So I better appeal to your reproductive self-interest rather than to your love. So all of this, you can see, like all of this from the metaphysics underneath science to environmental policy to our the psychology of civilization, all of these things go together. And so the shift toward utilitarian narratives in environmentalism, it's part of a much bigger picture. Let's be scientific, finally. Let's be hard-headed. Let's be realistic. It's like, yeah, it's like they kind of moved into the enemy camp. Said, okay, I'm going to use your concepts and your arguments and not the ones that are native to us. Because like in the book, I'm like, does anyone actually become an environmentalist because of all the money they're going to save? Like, what made you into an environmentalist? What made you care about the world? And I think that even when people say, well, you know, I became concerned about, you know, human extinction, I'm like, okay, really? So does that mean if human extinction were not a factor, you'd be okay with oil spills and clear cutting and the spread of deserts and the dying of all the fish in the ocean? You're okay with that? If human survival is not at stake? No, you're not. Bullshit. That's not why you care. You care because you love.
So what's the way out of the current predicament? How do you see that? You've emphasized that we need a new story and I think that's one of the key things that I picked up from you, that this old story just drives us crazy. How do we break out of that story? And is it up to us?
There's so many ways to answer that. On one level, it's simply to explore a new story that gives different answers to the basic questions that human beings ask. Who am I and why are we here? And where do we come from? And how does change happen? These are the core elements of a mythology. But it's not just an intellectual construct. It has a systemic, economic, political dimension, and it has a emotional, psychological, spiritual dimension as well. It's a state of being. Because when someone has, and it's related to the pain and trauma that we suffer in a society built on separation. So maybe you've experienced, and maybe people in your group have experienced, like when you have some kind of healing, physical or emotional, when you have a mystical experience, when you have a moment of deep forgiveness, when you're present at the passing of a loved one, and there's that infinite moment in that time. Maybe your beliefs change. Maybe you see the world in a different way. And it's not because somebody came at you with so much evidence that they changed your mind. It's that there was an inner shift. And that inner shift corresponds to a shift of belief and a shift in relationships. And on a global level, as more people go through these kinds of shifts, the systems built on the old state of being no longer have a solid foundation, and they begin to change. And it's also true that the systems bring us into alignment with them. There's a tension right now, a disconnection, a pull between who we are becoming, who we want to be, and the systems that we live in that try to hold us in an old consciousness. So the answer to your question is basically change on every level. The inner level, the relational level, the political, economic level, the level of the collective of all humanity. All of these changes have to go together. And, I guess in the book I touched on multiple levels. Let me just quickly say one more thing, really basically, it's we start seeing the world as alive and sacred. And we look into ourselves to find the knowing that that is true. And how do I feel seeing the world in that way? Maybe it requires practice, because we're so immersed in an ideology that says the world is dead. It's just, and that the appearance of life is just it's an illusion. It's a bunch of particles moving around. But no, the world is alive, and you know that. And the world is sacred and precious, and you know that. And you are here to contribute to its aliveness and to its beauty. That's why you're here. How does it feel to step into that story? It feels different than the Newtonian, Cartesian, mechanical universe story. It feels different. So part of the work is to really inhabit that worldview. How do I feel, and what hurts when I step into that? And what am I afraid of? Who do I become? Am I ready to become that person?
So you mentioned the key word there, in my opinion, I'm speaking from the personal experience, that it's just practices which count ultimately on the grassroots level. And that's I remember I think I mentioned that, the fascinating conversation that you had with Rupert Sheldrake, I think it was the first one where Rupert said that the two key practices are meditation and you also mentioned psychedelics, that these can give you the different perspective. And you also one of your articles that I've read many of your articles, but one that I read was, I think, called Psychedelics and Systems Change. Can you perhaps elaborate on that topic?
Yeah, I think that psychedelics are very important medicines for our time, because we can't easily break out. Like we sense that we're stuck in our religion, which isn't just science. Okay, science is just part of a much bigger mythology that we're kind of stuck in, and we sense its confinement. We know that there's something outside of it, but we can't get there by ourselves. So psychedelics, for example, ayahuasca, like people take ayahuasca and they have a direct experience of the planet's aliveness, of vines and tendrils, like penetrating everything and expressing as being. Like they have a direct experience of that. And a lot of people coming out of that experience, they're like, I knew it. Thank you for showing me what I knew, but didn't know that I knew, And then then, okay, how do you integrate that experience? Because you find yourself immersed in a world that denies that truth that you just experienced all the time. Denies it, you know, even through the standardized commodities that surround us, through the right angles of our buildings, through the economic system, the standardization of money, you know, like the distancing of relationships, like everything about our society tells us that we do not live among sacred beings in a sacred world, the way that we treat the environment. So the knowledge that is delivered by psychedelics can be a very lonely knowledge, because it doesn't look like other people believe that or have experienced that. And so you think, maybe I'm crazy. And that's why it's so important, I think, in addition to these personal experiences that you might get from psychedelics, to also build a new culture where we look at each other and we're like, yeah, I experienced that too. You're not crazy. And yes, it is important to live this knowledge. Otherwise, I'm going to wither away and die. Knowing what I know now, I cannot live in any other way. I cannot deny my soul. I have to put this into practice somehow. And just to validate that in each other, to validate our emerging understanding of how to be human, is so important. This is something that can happen in groups, you know, that we do collectively. Sanity is a group project. Enlightenment is a group project.
That's a good one. Yeah. Sanity is a group project. That's a good one. Yeah, so, but yeah. You came out of Yale with a double degree in mathematics and philosophy. So you were pretty much indoctrinated into that de facto religion of our times. If I may, you've told it in Russell Brand's show, but just for our listeners, what made you to get the different perspective?
Yeah, so on the one hand, even though I was indoctrinated into that, I had a silent protest against it the whole time. And that protest allowed me to be open to data points that didn't fit into that worldview. And I found those data points through psychedelics and also through my cultural experiences living in Taiwan and encountering phenomena that my education told me were utterly impossible. But I was experiencing them firsthand. So how could I, so if I hadn't already been carrying that protest, that dissent, then maybe these experiences, I would have said, oh, you know, whatever, that wasn't real, that person's lying, I didn't really experience that, there must be some explanation. But because I was already very discontented with the confines of the world that philosophy and mathematics had offered me, you know, and science, because I was discontented, when I experienced these data points, I was more like, yeah, I knew it. You know, thank you. I knew something existed beyond what had been narrated to me as real. So these included Chinese medicine stuff, Qigong stuff, stuff from like the shamanic traditions of Taiwan, you know, just like the commonality of people seeing ghosts, you know, like some of the ghost stories that were not, it wasn't like, ooh, let me tell you a ghost story. It was like, oh yeah, like, you know, like a taxi driver said, yeah, you know, the strangest thing happened the other night. I picked up a passenger, a woman dressed in wedding clothes. And she said to take her to this old part of town to an address. And I got there and the building didn't exist. And when I turned around to tell her that to verify the address, she was gone. And I'd been driving the whole time. I don't see how she could have gotten out. And like then I did some research and discovered that that building was, you know, a hotel that burned down decades ago. That's why that address doesn't exist. So what does he do? Does this like shock him and cause him to change his entire worldview? No, because it's not actually that special in Taiwan and, you know, in those times. Instead, he goes to a Taoist priest and the priest performs, you know, a ceremony on his taxi cab, you know, to clean out the ghostly energies, you know, and he's on his happy way. So like, you know, you can easily explain that story in scientific terms. You could say he's making it up. You could say that the woman got out at a crosswalk or, you know, got out at a traffic light and he didn't notice. Like, you can easily explain it. But for one thing, that explanation seemed like a little bit desperate, a little bit of like, well, it must have been something like that. I know better than he does what's real. Because I'm what? I'm a white foreigner educated at Yale and he's just a taxi driver. Like, there's a kind of patronizing arrogance to that way of explaining everybody else's experiences in terms of my religion. Okay. And the other thing is when you hear 10, 20, 50 stories like that and experience some things yourself, then it's like, who's rational here? You know, what's rational?
Or empirical, for that matter.
Or empirical, right. So in the end, I had to like, every time somebody, in my country, there's this big thing about trust science, about whatever issue you're talking about. Science-based this, science-based that. And I'm like, science, I've experienced things directly that science says is impossible. Why should I trust science? Does that mean that science is useless? No. No religion is useless. Religion is powerful. It offers a path to truth, a path, not the only path. It allows the rituals that come from a religion are powerful too. The rituals that come from science that are called technology can achieve some things very well, but they cannot achieve everything. There are problems that we face today that cannot be solved with the religion that created them, called science, that require other ways of engaging the world, other narratives, other mythologies. And we're experiencing this as a society. Like, our problems were supposed to have been solved by now, by the social sciences, you know, by medical science. We weren't supposed to still be sick in this year of 2021. When I was a kid in the 70s, I mean, we were on the verge of conquering all disease. The common cold will be the last one. That'll be gone by the year 2000. You're close to my age as well. You know, you remember this time, I think.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. So, and in the Soviet bloc, it was the same attitude.
Precisely, right? Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's I mean, partly thanks to you and partly the other authors. One idea that has struck me is that the virus is really in the sort of operating system. One application froze at the beginning of 90s, and the other seems to be in big trouble now. And that's a sort of common operating system behind these two applications, which is really struggling now. What do you think of that?
Yes,
that metaphor. Yeah. Right. Well, the other thing, just for today, we had the meeting. I just wrote up a few quotes from the book. We know in our poetic hearts that the atmospheric climate somehow mirrors the political climate. To bring the political side back into that, how would you that enlarge on that? Passage.
Yeah. So, I mean, it stands to reason that at a time of boiling anger, burning resentment. Seething hatred. I mean, these are all heat metaphors, you know. It stands to reason that we would have a climate that's getting hotter. Although, you know, more and more, since I wrote that book, it's becoming to me more and more plain that we're not facing runaway global warming. What we are facing is, I said it in the book, derangement, imbalanced extremes, where the global physiology can no longer easily maintain homeostasis. So in the last year, we've experienced record cold and record heat at the same time all over the world. And this maybe mirrors the social political climate too, of extremism and insanity, you know, derangement, decoherence.
Decoherence.
Yeah. I'm not sure how it is in Estonia.
I think my hypothesis is we just import the issues via Facebook and Twitter from the States, and we are just I see as the United States as the epicenter.
Yes,
that's a capital. We are just, you know, the outskirts of the country.
Right. Yeah. So basically, the country's coming apart. There's no civic commons anymore. There's no conversation to be had among people from different polarized opinions. There's not even, no one can agree on what is a valid source of evidence to even argue about. So there's no debate. It's just a shouting match.
Yeah.
It's falling apart. It's flying apart. And I think that mirrors what's happening to the biosphere, where whole systems that are decoupling. And decohering. So, and just on a really mundane level, when society is so fragmented and spending all of its energy fighting each other, how are we possibly going to change our ways? Because to heal the biosphere requires coherence. It requires unity, where we all say, here's what's important and here's what we can do about it. And if we did that, it would be easy to heal the biosphere, easy. All of the technologies, all of the methods to do that, to heal soil, to heal water, to heal biodiversity are available to us. We're just not doing them because we're not capable right now of making any change that requires coherence. It's like we're sitting on a boat and the boat is caught in a big whirlpool and it's spinning around, you know. And maybe if everybody got to the oars and started rowing all together, we could row out of the whirlpool. But instead, everybody's having a fist fight on the deck and we're just getting swept down. Like, the decoherence of society makes it impossible for us to change our course, which is causing the decoherence of the biosphere. But I think that there's a more mysterious level also, that the world reflects ourselves. And if, yeah, you know, in the book, I said something like a society in which we lock people up in prison is necessarily a society where we are destroying the environment. You know, it's like these things all go together. A society where the most vulnerable people are exploited will be a planet in which the most vulnerable places and ecosystems are exploited. It's the same mindset. And that means that as individual people of care and love, it doesn't matter where you devote your care. Like, you could devote it to your neighborhood, to your society, to other human beings, And the environmentalist says, oh, you're wasting your time because if we don't stop climate change, you know, there won't be any other human beings. But no, because how do we stop climate change? How do we stop ecocide? We stop it by changing human beings. So all of the work is the same work. All of the healing work is the same healing. And that means that you can trust what your heart calls you to do. And here's another level of the belief that the world is alive, that it's sacred, that it's intelligent, that there is, and that it has a wanting, to take it back to Aristotelian causes, that there's a wanting, that there's a final cause, that there's a destination to go to, like the world wants to become something. And the subject of the wanting, the world, is an inconceivably vast intelligence. And we're a tiny part of that. And even if you and I do not know how to heal the world, how to save the planet, boy, oh boy, I wish people would stop thinking that they know how to save the planet and telling everybody else how to do it. Something knows how to save the planet, though. But it's a much bigger than human intelligence. And when we are, when we bow into service to that intelligence and say, make use of me in this plan beyond what I can understand, make use of me, put me to good use, then that intelligence says, okay, I will communicate to you what to do. How does it communicate to you what to do? Through the heart, through what you care about, through what brings your love and passion to the surface.
Which is also kind of final cause, which pulls us from the future.
That's right. That's right. Yeah, it's the final cause. It's the destination. It's the what do we want to become? Like you can even say that what the world wants to become is a being as well. Part of this new mythology is to see the world as full of beingness. Everything is a being. Indigenous people thought that.
Anti-Cartesian view is basically the...
That's right. 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 The Cartesian view is that being is like this ghost in the machine.
Yeah.
And we're talking about restoring beingness to everything as Indigenous people commonly believe. Like they don't think that it's insane to talk to your sock or to believe a rock or a cloud or a river or a forest can communicate with humans and has consciousness. They don't, like we're the only people ever actually, modern society is the only people ever to think that. Oh. So this is a recovery of a perceptual habit that allows us to be part of a much more powerful change than we can accomplish with our, you know, force, which is good news because otherwise it's hopeless.
Right. Yeah. I just need trust in that final cause, I guess. Each individual and collective. That's the way I would put it.
Yeah. And where does the trust come from?
Where does it come from?
It comes from the little miracles that happen when I begin to trust it. And it comes from trusting my feeling that of what is significant and what is important and what isn't. Mm. And to know that I don't know. To be willing to, you know, like my mother passed last year, and while she was in her terminal decline, she was sick, she had cancer, you know, I spent quite a lot of time with her. And, you know, a very, very cynical person could say, Charles, that was a waste of time because she was going to die anyway. And what does it matter if she passed a little bit more peacefully? You could have spent that time working to stop climate change. Like, that's obviously inhuman. right? It's inhuman. You know that that is wrong. Some part of you knows that that is wrong, that that criticism is wrong. Let's trust that part of ourselves that knows what is important. If we trust that more, we're going to be a force for beauty on this earth.
How do you see, like 10 minutes to go, how do you see I'm not sure whether it's paradox or not, but on the one hand, the elites emphasize that we need action on the global scale. On the other hand, you emphasize the grassroots activities. And at the same time, there is, I think, one of the common themes in the present world is just almost everywhere, the confidence in the elites is dwindling. How do you pull these threads together? That's interesting.
Yeah. Yes, we need action on a global scale. And how do we do that? Like, do you write up some grand plan of how the action should happen and submit it to who? To the president, to Bill Gates, to teacher, you know, you submit your paper and argue for it and try to get everybody to believe you. Like, is that how global change happens? No way. I'm not saying that books, I mean, that's kind of what I did. Okay. I'm kind of making a joke at my own expense. And I'm not saying that books and ideas and persuasion is useless, but a lot more than that has to happen to change the world. I can't remember who said you can't reason somebody out of a belief that they didn't reason themselves into to begin with.
That's a very good one. Yes.
And also the other thing is that even if you do change the president's belief about something, does that mean that he can take different policies? Not necessarily, because what he does is constrained by the system. Like, how do you actually do global systems change? And I would say the answer is nobody knows. But it is a result of everything else, including all of these actions you call grassroots. So I'm not saying don't try to change government policies and corporate policies and global narratives. I'm not saying that, but I'm saying don't privilege that kind of action over the grassroots action, over the interpersonal and the inner action, because that action creates the conditions where the world-changing ideas even have a chance. Wow. Like, look what happened with the fall of communism. The reason that communism fell was that people didn't believe in it anymore. The challenges that beset the Soviet Union in the 1980s and 1990s, in the 60s, they would have been no problem. Because in the 60s, the entire Soviet elite deeply believed in the superiority of socialism. Khrushchev said, "We will bury you."
He did.
That wasn't bravado. Like, he actually believed, of course we will bury you because we're so superior. And any challenge to the system would have been easily overcome. But by the time of the 80s, no one in the Communist Party, no one in the Politburo, nobody actually believed in the system anymore. So as soon as it was challenged, they didn't hold on that tightly. You know, they didn't try to get it back. They didn't try to restore communism. No one believed in it anymore. It had hollowed out from the inside. So we live in a similar situation today, I think, at least in the West. Yeah. Maybe not so much in China, but in the West, no one really, like, that's one reason why the population accepted lockdown under COVID so easily. Because it's like, at least here is something different. Here is a relief from the tyranny of normal. Like, I don't want normal. Like, part of us wants things to break down because we want to be delivered from our condition, which no longer accommodates the growth of our souls. So I think that the crises that are coming fast and furious today will fundamentally change society. No one really wants to restore normal. Normal wasn't that great. We didn't believe in it. The normal of 2019, 2018, 2019.
Yeah, that's one of your sentences that kind of, I can't remember what, I think it was written after the Trump election, 2016, that's a variation on the theme that revolution is love, and of course, exactly, and you use the phrase that the bullshit detector, as soon as I hear the phrase revolution is love, the bullshit detector starts to kind of function, but yeah. You said that just what kind of helped me is that basically that we are together. The love in that context means the realization that we are all together in this crisis, and we are together in this uncertainty. That kind of helped me to understand what you're writing about. Just mm-hmm. How did you? That's just a couple of more comments on that theme, perhaps, before we.
The revolution is love.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like to describe love as the expansion of oneself to include another. If you love a person, then like the example of my wife, you know, her happiness is part of my happiness. If she's suffering, I'm suffering. She's not separate from me. She's part of me. My child, if my child is suffering, I can't say, oh, that's just him. You know, I'm fine. Like if the same as if I have, you know, a heart problem, I can't say, well, that's just my heart. I'm fine because I'm not separate from my heart. So love is the way that the circle of the self expands to include others. Because we are in an age of separation, a story of separation that says who you are is a separate self, a Cartesian consciousness in a flesh robot, a biologically programmed, genetically programmed, self-interest maximizing machine, an economic man, a soul encased in flesh, et cetera, et cetera. Because we live in that, and our whole system is built on that separate self, the whole control of nature, the competitive economy, exploitation, like all of this is built on separation. The story of separation. Therefore, the revolution is a story of interbeing, interconnection, and love is how that happens. Love is what we call the expansion of the self beyond the separate self. So that's why I say the revolution is love. It's not, yeah, the revolution is not that we get a bit more clever at controlling the other, dominating the other, you know, finding the bad guys and killing them or locking them up, identifying evil, identifying something to control, something to go to war against. That mindset is the same whether you're talking about, you know, the US war on terror or the war on germs or the war on carbon. This basic pattern of find something to control, that is just more of the same. Really, if we're talking about the healing the biosphere, healing the planet, it's to understand that we're not separate from it. and that these are beings that we love. And then what comes out of that love? It's to protect and heal all of the places that are part of our collective being. And I could make similar arguments about health, you know, that the whole paradigm of find something to control, a virus, and we'll be healthier that way. We've been getting less and less healthy, at least in my country, for my entire lifetime. Chronic disease, autoimmune conditions, allergies, obesity. And it's not because of a virus, but we did nothing about it. Now we have an object to battle, and we changed the whole society to fight this germ that, you know, kills 0.1% of the people. Why haven't we made changes at that scale to fight, to address autoimmunity and depression and addiction and obesity, et cetera, which afflicts 50% or more of the population? Because we don't know how, because it's not a fight, actually. So the revolution means it's a different kind of revolution. It's not find something to overthrow, but it is the word revolution means a turning. So it's a turning back toward what we really are. It's a turning.
Well, that's a good note at which to end. And thank you so much for your time.